Hello everyone, welcome back to the world of LTE. Today we'll start a new series on LTE architecture. Before we know the architecture, we need to understand why do we need the LTE. In this video, we will start with major reasons that give rise to the need of LTE. We will also discuss a little about the user equipment before we can dive into the RAN and core parts in our subsequent videos. The period of 2000 to 2010 saw a growth from 500 million to more than 4.5 billion mobile subscribers. It was driven by user-friendly and attractive devices such as iPhone in 2007 and Android-based smartphones which started from 2008. Network operators had previously tried to encourage the growth of mobile data by the introduction of flat rate charging schemes that permitted unlimited data downloads. As a result of these, networks started congesting in the year around 2010, leading to a requirement of increase in network capacity. The UMTS or 3G was a huge upgrade to GSM GPRS or 2G, but it was again facing some design limitations. That's why the governing body 3GPP decided to redesign the RAN and the core part. For example, specifying an interface with a carrier bandwidth of 5 MHz in WCDMA was a bold step. It performed well in limits, but in practice it didn't scale up very well. We had discussed earlier that higher the frequency means lower is the time between two transmission steps, which results in higher multipath fading. That's why air interface was redesigned and OFDM was introduced, where instead of spreading a signal over the entire band, the data is transmitted over many narrow bands of 180 kHz. As a result, the attainable data rate compared to UMTS is similar for same bandwidth, but multipath fading is greatly reduced. It also provides flexibility, as LTE can have bandwidth from 1.25 MHz to up to 20 MHz, which can be further increased by carrier aggregation, thus providing more efficient bandwidth utilization. Now, 2G or 3G uses traditional circuit switched core for voice and SMS and packet switched core for data. That means operator has to maintain two core networks simultaneously. A major change in LTE was adoption of all IP-based core network, which means switching to VOIP or, in this case, voice over LTE. It greatly simplifies the design and implementation of air interface, radio network, and core. Quality of service mechanism on all interface ensures that bandwidth and other requirements of voice calls can be met even when the capacity limit are reached. It is difficult to implement, that's why operators use circuit switch fallback to 2G or 3G for voice calls. However, operators are migrating to voice over LTE as it is cheaper and more versatile. With the advent of IoT devices, the total number of connected devices is expected to reach 28 billion by 2021. Now, for these devices, latency is more important than bandwidth. So, a faster backhaul was need of the hour. In LTE, the maximum allowed delay is of the range 50 milliseconds to 300 milliseconds, depending upon the quality of service. Also, all interfaces between network nodes in LTE are now based on IP, including the backhaul connection to the radio base stations. Again, this is a great simplification compared to earlier technologies that were initially based on E1, ATM, and frame relay links, with most of them being narrowband and expensive. Now you can see that the major changes were done in the radio access part. But in order to access the radio, we need to have a device. So before we can dive into the architecture, let us understand the device used by an end user. In LTE specification, the mobile device is referred to as user equipment, same as in UMTS. The internal architecture of the user equipment for LTE is identical to the one used by UMTS and GSM, which is actually a mobile equipment. The mobile equipment comprises of the following important modules: mobile termination, this handles all the communication functions; terminal equipment, this terminates the data streams; and universal integrated circuit card, also known as the SIM card. The mobile termination and terminal equipment is basically the antenna. In LTE, the SIM card can either run an application known as the Universal Subscriber Identity Module or USIM. A USIM stores user-specific data very similar to 3G SIM card. This keeps information about the user's phone number, home network identity, and security keys. It can also have iSIM module. iSIM carry a lot of information used in SIP protocols such as your IP Multimedia Private Identity or IMP, domain, IP Multimedia Public Identity IMPU, and cipher keys which are used to encrypt information. So this application is used for SIP or IMS procedures, consequently VoLTE calls. So friends, in this video we have seen what gave rise to the need of LTE. We have also seen the functioning of user equipment. In our next video, we will discuss the most complex section of LTE network architecture, that is the RAN part. Till then, take care. Happy learning.